Thank you for tuning in to LA Talk Live, reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. Stay tuned.
Hey everybody, Tim Alexander's on the air. Sorry I'm a couple minutes late, but Daddy's home. So, here we are on the fourth show of What Would My Daddy Say? And everybody listening to me, start coming up with something to call me about. It's got to be something you want to ask me. So, I am here. Tim Alexander, What Would My Daddy Say? Show number 4. And we should have a good show today. What do I want to talk about today? Anybody want to call in? Before I start just talking about what I want to talk about, we can talk about what you want to talk about if you call the number. And if you look on the screen, you will see the number right under me, right under my, right there. There it is. There's a number right there. Call that number, and we can talk about what's going on in your life. So, today is going to be Let's Blame Everybody Day. Let's blame everybody. Blame them for what, you say? Well, let's blame them for everything that's not working. I know that sounds bizarre, but quite often I get accused of blaming and pointing the fingers and bashing and saying women this and men that and the government this. And often women say that I hold them too responsible. That's arguable. That's an opinion. Do I hold them too responsible? Being a woman and laying down with the wrong man does indeed give you a lot to be responsible for. And when you have that much to be responsible for, who else can I talk to about your responsibility? The other person? Or do I have to talk to you about your responsibility? Are the men responsible? Absolutely. Everybody is responsible for the mess that we're making out of family, our lives, and our children's lives. All of us. So let's start to analyze who's responsible for what. Who should I go on first, the men or the women? All right, let's talk about the men. I say things about women. Women say, well, what about the men? Why do you want to blame me? What about him? Yeah, I agree. Men are very responsible for not taking care of their children when they don't. Any man that does not take care of his children, I just can't respect. I had a best friend for years, and he was married. He wasn't handling his business. He wasn't respecting his wife. He decided he wanted to be a pothead and just be irresponsible, and I couldn't respect that. I've met men, seen the way they deal with their children. The way they don't deal with their children. I can't respect that. Can't be a part of it. Any man out there that is not taking care of his children, I don't respect you. I don't care who you are. I just don't respect you. If you have a child, you have to take care of it. If you're a man that has a child, you grew up one of two ways. You grew up with a parent or without a parent. If you grew up, parents, you grew up with a father in your life, or you grew up without a father in your life. Either way, you should have learned a lesson. If you grew up with a father in your life, then you should know what your responsibility is. You should clearly and firmly know what your responsibility is as a father to be in your child's life. You have a clear roadmap to what your father meant to you, who your father was to you, how important his presence was in your life. If you didn't have a father in your life, you clearly know how much that hurts. You know what you missed. You know what it feels like to say, where is the other side of me? You know what it feels like to not have a father to step in and protect you from your mother's disposition or your mother's energy when maybe she didn't understand you. You know what it's like to feel an inadequacy as a man because you have questions that you can't resolve about what your manhood should be like, how it should be shaped. There's a lot of things that you know firsthand are missing in your life because you didn't have a father. So, with both of these two ways you could have been raised, with a father in your life or without, what about you doesn't seem to get the importance of your role and your handling your responsibility as a father in your child's life? How do you let that slip through your fingers? You actually make children and just don't care? You were actually able to lay down with a woman, maybe you wanted to be with her, maybe you loved her, maybe it was your girlfriend, maybe you were married, maybe you were together 4 or 5 years, maybe together a few months, maybe you just wanted sex. However you did it, how do you get somebody pregnant and they birth the child into the world that's 50% of you, that looks like you, that acts like you, that quite possibly could have your last name, and you just walk around and don't take care of it? Really? I mean, really? And how is that supposed to work out? Do you value your own seed? Do you respect your legacy? When that child grows up with potentially, usually, some issues, be they small or great, do you really have no sense of responsibility for that? Whose problem is it? We have to, as men, stand up and realize that there is a part of the world that needs our presence. There's a part of the world that can't function correctly without the presence of a man. Most women need a man at some point in their life. Actually, all women do. Even if they're lesbians, they need a car mechanic, and those are usually men. We have a social responsibility to look out for the women folk, whether they are our women or whether they are just women in general that need some assistance with making it through the world. You can help a single mother that has children that she's having a problem with. Help advise or guide or mentor the children. There's nothing wrong with that. When is the last time you as a man stood up and said, I'm going to speak some life, some energy, and some guidance into these children's lives? I see these boys going in the wrong direction. I'm going to stand as a man and tell them what's wrong with what they're doing. When do we see our responsibility to give something back, to make sure that we have something in the future? That's what men do. When are we, the collective man, going to learn that our children are our responsibility? That the children of a woman whose life we come into that have a irresponsible man become our responsibility? It's part of the package. When are we going to say the future of the world is our responsibility as men? Do we expect the world to lead itself? Do we expect children to grow up to be proper, balanced adults on their own? No. Do we really expect mom to do that on her own? Mom and grandma and auntie? Do we really expect them to raise our future with the proper balance on their own without us being involved in it? Does that even sound right to anybody? How will the boys learn to be men if men don't teach them man? How would you learn to speak French without a French teacher? Even if you did learn to somehow or another get through the words with a book, you still wouldn't pronounce them right. You would speak some really bad French if you never heard it spoken and never experienced the conversation of two people actually speaking functional conversational French. You just can't fill in the gaps. How are our boys going to be men if men don't input some man into them as a real living, breathing example of manhood? How are our girls going to know what to expect of a man, how a man should treat them, how they should treat a man? Is a man something that just comes into your life and gets you pregnant? Then you chase him for 18 years and see if you can try to get him to take care of his child? That's what some women think a man is. And those are the only kind of men they get. Those are the only kind of men they saw. You grow up, you do what mama did. You get pregnant 3 times, you go chase all those guys. At what point do we stand up as men and explain to our young women that no, it's not supposed to work like that? You have to have more self-respect. If you're not sure who that guy is, you bring him by, you let me check him out. I will tell you if he's worthy of your time. I can't say I'll be 100% right, but I sure can put you in the ballpark. When are we men going to stand up and lead? I'm trying. I'm not perfect, but I'm trying. I talk to people every day from the position of a man. I have a show now to try to speak like a good old school balanced man with values, with morals, with scruples, with a God-centeredness should talk to his kids. The way I'm going to talk to Alan and Brandon one day when they get older. I won't have to talk much because Alan and Brandon already know what their job is as a man. They fully know, and they will tell you as a man what their job is. They already tell me that one day they want to grow up and be a dad and take care of their children like I take care of them. They already know. So, you know, I'll probably have to tell them some other things, but not about being a man. Nah. My sons at 6 years old have more man in them than a lot of 30-year-olds. You know why? A man was there to teach the man. Learning man starts at a very young age. Learning man starts in your childhood, early childhood, from a baby. I've been teaching my sons man. It's not their mother's job. Their mother can teach a woman. She can't teach the man. Fortunately, their mother picked good. I'm a good dad. If you didn't pick good, then guess who picked him? You didn't lay down with yourself and get pregnant. You lay down with somebody else. Oops, did I just switch gears? Am I talking to women now? Okay, let me stay on the men for a minute. Men, when are you going to realize that your children are going to be less than they could be without you? When, oh, somebody's calling me. They want to shut me up. Okay, here we go. Hello, caller. Hello, caller. Can you hear me? Caller? Can you hear me, caller? Hello, caller. Okay. Well, I guess the caller couldn't hear me. Maybe they'll call back. Anyway, as I was saying, your children will be less than all they could be if they don't have you there to assist in teaching them how to be all that they could and can and should be. They will not learn it on their own. They will not learn it from television. They will not learn it from the current music playing on the radio. They can learn a portion of it from mom and grandma. A portion of it. Now, how big that portion is and how well that portion is taught, that's arguable, but they'll learn a portion of it. How do you feel about the fact that if you're not there, they're not learning any of it from you? Are your children really not your responsibility in your mind? It doesn't matter how you made your child. It doesn't matter what happened in the relationship. A lot of things don't matter. What matters is today is today, and tomorrow is tomorrow, and the next day is the next day, and the next week, and the next year, and the next lifetime. Your presence and your standing up today and making those efforts to be a part of that child's life is going to affect the entire outcome of all those different days and weeks and months and years. I remember today at 55 things that my father did and said when I was 5 and 6 years old. I remember places he took me, things he said to me, things he made me do, things he wouldn't allow me to do. I remember how sometimes I didn't understand my mother or she was being too hard on me. He would sit me down and explain to me and let me know that if mama was being too hard on me, to let him know. And he would work it out. I remember my dad. My dad raised me. The man I am now today is because of my dad, and I'm proud. If I didn't have my dad, I'd have been the general sack of crap that so many, not all, but that so many of our fatherless men have allowed themselves to become. I say allowed. Could they do better? Yeah, they could. But better is relevant. What is better? A little better is better, but is that enough? If you don't have much of an example of what better is, then you usually don't seek to be much better. If the status quo becomes you and your broken fatherless friends, because everybody you know is just as fatherless, and you all magically see children as a woman's problem, then where's the motivation to even try to be better? Is that an excuse? No. Nope, not an excuse. Is it a reality? It absolutely is a reality. People who don't know to do better, who haven't seen the importance of doing better, usually don't strive very hard to be better. We learn by examples. We learn by patterns. The things that are input into our life early are what sets the direction for our life. They say the most important times in a child's life are the first 6 years. That first 6 years sets them on the path to where they're going to go and where they're going to end up. If the first 6 years of your life don't have the balance, not just the first six, but all of them, actually. If the years of your life don't give you the balance of two parents as an integral, equal, important factor in your maturation, then you will not see your responsibility as a man as important in most instances. Or you will always see your responsibility of manhood as second to a woman. Men's responsibility to their children are not second to mama. Actually, mama's responsibilities to her children are not greater than daddy's. They're equal. They're equally as important, but functionally different. In some ways, the big ticket items, discipline, respect, motivation, courage, the big ticket items, those come from dad in the proper balance. Not saying some mothers haven't filled those positions in their child's life, but in the proper balance, that's daddy work. Mothers teach nurturing. They teach details. They domesticate the wild animals they have that are called children. We need both sides. Sometimes the roles reverse. The fathers are more domestic and the mothers are more aggressive. A little odd to me personally, but for quite a few, it works. I think the roles are a little out of order, a little distorted, but hey, as long as you get that balance of both sides, it's definitely better than only having the imbalance of one side. One parent just isn't quite as good as two parents. Two great parents is best. One great parent, one so-so parent, you know, that can work. One great parent and one kind of bad parent, not good, but you can still learn something from that bad parent, and you can learn a lot from the good parent who shows you how to navigate the bad parent. Lessons come from all different directions. One parent, even one great parent, there's still some things missing. Imagine having one ear. You can still hear, but it's one ear. And your hearing on that side is going to be a little bit limited. You have to hear from this side. If somebody's over here talking, you're going to say, hey, wait a minute, I can't hear from that side. Can you go over here and talk? You try to put on stereo headphones. You're only going to hear half the signal. If you have reduced hearing in one ear, you can kind of find an equilibrium. You still get most of the information you need. Ideally, it's best to have two great ears. It would work the same with one eye. It would work the same with one nostril. That would be kind of weird. Only half the air. That means that this nostril would be noisier because it has to suck double air. When your life only has one parent, you have to try to make a full life out of a double portion of one parent. Instead of learning two different type of lessons, you're primarily learning one lesson. You have to take that and kind of spread it around on your own and fill in the gaps if you have any idea what the gaps are. That's a challenge. I'm glad I have two legs. I'm glad I have two hands. I can pick up something with two hands and I can like pull it apart. That would be really hard to do with one hand, to pull that apart. I'm glad I don't have to experience working with one hand. One parent. One single individual parent. Two people lay down and made a third person. And that person is raised by one parent. Who in the sound of my voice does that sound right to? If growing up with one parent sounds right to you, give me a call and tell me why that's such a wonderful thing. I'm going to argue with you if you call me and tell me that growing up with one parent is a wonderful thing. Now, the fact that parent is there and doing a great job and doing the best they can is a wonderful thing. But is that more wonderful than having a second equally as dedicated parent? Because the two people that found each other and came together and had sexual intercourse did an equally good job of knowing who they were and finding a person who really is who they needed so they can make a cohesive, balanced relationship and at the proper time birth the child into the world and then spend the rest of their days raising that child together as a unit. Who can tell me that one parent is better than that? Yeah, men are responsible for a lot of things. If you didn't have a father, at some point, you grow up enough to realize it hurt you. At some point, you get an inkling of an idea of how your life could have been different and better if you had a father. And even though you may not know how it should be done from the application in your own personal life, you can still figure out how to do a pretty decent job. Maybe I should take my child places. Maybe I should talk to my child about life. I have learned a few things that they don't know yet because they're a child. Maybe I should tell my child I love them, play ball with them, take them shopping, discipline them, protect them, show them I care by getting involved in school, their athletic activities. Maybe I should teach them a trade that I know. Maybe I should be my daughter's first date and once a week take her someplace. Maybe I should be my son's sparring partner, teach him how to be rough so he can protect himself. Yeah, I didn't have a dad, but if I did have a dad, that's what I would have wanted him to do. So you know what? I think I'm going to do the best I can, and I'm going to father as best as I can. I'm going to start by being there as much as I possibly can be. I'm going to see if I can help my son to go through life and not have some of the issues I had not having a father. You can actually try that. And you're probably going to be better at it than you think if you try. Go ahead. You have a child. Try to be a father. You know what else you can do? You can talk to other men that are fathers, that are effective fathers. You've got to know one somewhere. Ask him, what do I do? I have a son, I have a daughter. What do I do in this situation? How can I help my son and my daughter to be the kind of person I know they should be? How can I help them to not endure some of the things that I went through as a child? How can I help them to see that when they become an adult, that their responsibility is to carry on and be a responsible person. Be a responsible person to their children. Be a responsible person to society. Be a responsible person just in general. I've got to teach my kids something. I've seen other kids grow up, and I don't like the way they grew up. I know other guys my age. I know other male children. I know other females that just don't live their lives right. There's something broken inside. How can I keep that broken from attaching itself to my children? That's done by being there and fathering as best as you can, no matter what you don't know. There are books, there are seminars, there are classes, churches can help. Other men who've walked in their manhood longer than you have or differently than you have. There's some kind of way that you can learn how to be a father. Here's a call. Hello, caller.
Yes, hello.
Hi.
A question about, you're talking a lot about the role of a father, and that's all good. But then there's, if someone is lucky enough to also know his grandfather, what role do you think a grandfather, can he kind of just now have fun with his grandchildren? Or, for example, my grandfather, you know, my father would be the disciplinarian and this and that, and then my grandfather behind my father's back would, like, if my father, as an example, my father would say, okay, you can't have candy before dinner, or my mother too, you know, and I would cry when I was little and I wanted candy, you know, like things kids do. And then when my parents weren't looking, my grandfather would take me and he would give me candy, you know. Now, with that, you know, was that wrong? Or because he's a grandfather, maybe he can get away with it, because then I've got my, because I know when I'm back with my parents, I've got to be on the straight and narrow again.
Well, as long as he didn't feed you enough candy to kill you, I guess it was okay. That's one of the things.
Well, he can kind of relax and enjoy his grandchildren.
Absolutely. That's
so then
one
have
of
to always be, you know, there is some discipline involved. They can't just completely let go, but
yes.
You know, do you agree with that or?
That's one of the things that endears kids to their grandparents. There's two kinds of grandparents you can have. You can have those really nice, sweet grandparents that let you get away with stuff and buy you things and spoil you. Or you can have those mean, grumpy grandparents that you hate to go and see. Those things are little naughty grandparent things, but they're fine in small doses because it makes the kids feel like they're a little special. And sometimes kids do need to break that routine. And sometimes grandparents are a whole lot softer than they were as parents. A lot of grandparents were very hard on their kids and very soft on their grandkids. They get kind of spongy and soft when they get older. So that's somewhat normal. But now the unfortunate thing is so many children do not have adequate grandparents. Most of today's younger children today do not have active grandfathers because their mother did not have an active father.
Exactly.
How can they have a grandfather if their mother didn't have a father? We've got two generations, even three generations of missing men in some children's lives. No father, grandfather, or great-grandfather. They're just out there soaking up estrogen energy and trying to make manhood out of that. And it's not working.
If we could get that into the minds of young men that, you know, it's one thing, like you're saying, be the good father, but then all the enjoyment they would get in life, because then when they're old, they could look forward to having, you know, a couple of grandkids and just do the fun part of it, too. And, of course, having children can be fun, too. It's not all fun, but it's more fun being a grandparent. I don't know. That hopefully will encourage more young men to, you know, step up to their role.
Well, I'm going to do my best to try to encourage it. That's my whole point. You know, as I said at the beginning of the show, some people think I'm too hard on women, but I'm really kind of hard on everybody. And in the second part of this show, I'm going to get back to the women, and now I'm going to be hard on them. I was nice. I went in on the guys first. Wasn't that nice of me? You didn't expect that, did you? Anyway, I'm coming back for the ladies because they got some responsibility, too.
You know, what you're saying about how we are the ones who make the decision and make sure to only allow men that we at least show some indication that they're going to be good fathers, you know, not just because we're lonely, go off with anyone.
They don't look for good fathers. If I can be crude, they look for a good lay. And that's all they get. They get laid, and then he's out, and then there they are. And you have to look for more than a good sexual partner when you lay down to have sex. Sex produces children. And you have to start thinking in terms of building a cohesive family unit and not a lot of sexual experiences and not just on your girl bedpost.
That's
true. And the irresponsibility is a huge contributor, which I'm going to get into in part two. I'm going to go to a little station break for a second and I'm going to come back and I'm going to blame the ladies. How's that?
Get on us.
I'm going to blame the ladies, and you're going to say I'm bashing. I don't care what you call it, but I'm going to tell you your part of why you're messing up, helping mess up our future. It's two people that make a child. Both parties are responsible. So thanks for your call. I'm going to play some music for a moment, and I'm going to come back. And if anybody hears my voice and disagrees with anything I say, call me and disagree, or call me and agree. I don't care. Just call me. Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye. And here we go. We're going to take a station break. And we're going to play some music. Let's see. What are we going to play? We're going to play Superwoman. Why not? Let's see. Okay, that's not going to play. Got a little technical glitch here, trying to get some music for y'all. And it's going to come up shortly. Oops. Okay. I'm going to put my banner up while I try to figure out what I did wrong here. I'm new on my board, and every once in a while I make a mistake. And somebody's coming in to bail me out. So anyway, here comes a banner, and you're going to hear some music shortly, and I'll be back. What would my daddy say with Tim Alexander? And thank you to the station guy for coming in to bail me out.
Thank you for tuning in to L.A. Talk Live,
yeah,
reality radio,
handcrafted
for your listening pleasure. This is L.A. Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. Stay tuned.
Hey, y'all. I'm Shaquem Williams, and I'm the host of The Shock Factor here on L.A. Talk Live. We broadcast to the world every Friday at 8 o'clock Pacific Standard Time. Live music, live performances. We're just live. Chef Momo, Life MC, Diana, and once again, your host, Shaquem Williams. So come join us every Friday here at L.A. Talk Live, the world-leading broadcasting internet radio station. The Shock Factor. The Shock Factor.
Hey everybody, it's your man Sabir Bey back on your airwaves, inviting you to join us every Tuesday.
I'm always monitoring. It's a good show,
Show discussing history, law, and hip hop every Tuesday, 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. The Sabir Bey Show, exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You also can catch us on iTunes Radio and R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio. Or watch us and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality Radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hi, I'm Onyx Monopoly, inviting you to join me every Monday at 11 a.m. for my new show, Hooked on Onyx, spreading motivation and inspiration through wisdom, experience, and music. So don't forget to tune in to Hooked on Onyx, Mondays at 11 a.m., exclusively on LATalkLive.com, the LA Talk Broadcast Network. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, TuneIn Radio, Live 365, Radio Flag, and AHA Radio. Or watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality Radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hey, I'm back. Oops, there's an open mic. You got to hear a little behind the scenes. Hey, what can I say? I'm not a professional yet, but I'm working on it. Haha. Tim Alexander, what would my daddy say? Back on the air. We just had to fix a few things. Gave me some different lighting. How you like that? Better look? How'd I look? Okay, different lighting. My man Richard Carr, the man who makes it all happen. He's training me on how to get this right. So here we go. We're back. Listen to some old school music, Wildflower. I love that song as a kid. Wow. Great song. So, now we're back. Could it possibly be that women have some responsibility in why our families are a little bit different? Why, when so many people say, men are no good, men are dogs, men need to stand up and be men, men need to handle their responsibility, men need to lead, men need to respect women, men need to stop being so whorish, men need to learn how to work and provide, pay child support, men are lazy, they want to sit around and not do anything, they want a woman to take care of them. Men want a woman to take care of them. A lot of things are said about men. Let me see. They're weak. They're no good dogs. They end out of jail. They don't have an education. There's so many things said about men. Well, who raised them? Let me see. If the father wasn't there, there's inadequacies in the men that the boys became. Yeah, it's definitely a problem if the father wasn't there. But in most cases, the mother was there. And in a lot of cases, that boy whose father wasn't there has a brother and a sister who has a different father who wasn't there. How many not their fathers? How many not their fathers can one woman collect and not get told that she is a part of the problem? I'll let that sink in. For the viewers who are my Facebook fans, you know you can also watch me on Facebook. If you go to my Facebook page, Tim Alexander LA, you see the link at the top of my page. If you click it, the show will be sitting right there on Facebook. Now, did that sink in? Why do I know a woman that has 6 kids by 5 different men, and she never changed her name one time through marriage? 6 children, 5 men, 0 paying child support. What kind of crappy man record is that? Now that's a little bit extreme, 6 kids with 5 men. I have children with one woman, and we both take care of our children. That means that both of us found somebody responsible before we made a child. This person has 5 no good baby daddies. One person, 5 no good baby daddies. And she blames all of them for not being there and not taking care of their children. Now, if you are a no good man, you're only a no good man. You only get the distinction of being a no good baby daddy when some dummy gives you a baby. Oops, did I say dummy? Was that harsh? Maybe I should not say dummy. When some irresponsible, is that okay? No condom, not married. Okay, you don't want to say irresponsible? Okay. When some careless, is that accurate? When some undiscerning, oh, that's a good one. When some undiscerning woman who means well and falls in love with some guy who she knows is a player, when she falls in love with some guy who's got about 3 or 4 kids he's not taking care of, and because she believes in her heart that he's really a good person deep down inside, even though when she met him he had a girlfriend and she knew that she was messing with him while he had a girlfriend, but deep down inside he's a good guy and she knows that she loves him, he's going to change. And she meant well, and even though they didn't really do anything but have sex, he never took her any place and never did anything for her. But somehow or another, because she meant well and was maybe a little naive, she thought she had a man that when she got pregnant would be a great dad to his child, their child, for 25 years to help raise that child to adult maturation. So, is it okay if I call that naive? Without pissing somebody off and saying I'm bashing? I can't call it wise. I can't call it proper, correct. Maybe she's naive because she didn't have a father to say, no, not that guy. No way, not that guy. You are not going out with that guy. Why didn't her mother tell her? Her mother must have experience in bad men, because obviously the man she picked for her daughter, wasn't a good enough man to father his daughter. Maybe she picked 2 or 3 bad men to have children by. Why can't she tell her children, her daughters, how to avoid a bad man? Why do so many mothers tell their daughters that men are going to hurt you, they're going to cheat on you, they're going to act up? At least find a man that has money. So at least when it blows up, you can get some money. Why do women complain that men are lazy and don't do anything and don't work and sit around the house and don't pay any bills and expect to be fed and want to drive your car and mess up your credit and everything else that women complain about? Didn't a woman raise them? Shouldn't she have done a better job of making sure that her sons would never, ever, ever hurt one of her fellow, I can't call them fellow women, because I said fellow, but hurt another sister, another woman. The boys that they raised in manhood are now out hurting women. Shouldn't she feel bad about that? Why did Mama raise men that are out hurting women? Why don't the little men that Mama raised all by herself that she's so proud of, why don't these little men grow up and be responsible big men? How come Mama's little men are out making babies, and before one baby comes out, they're going out to make another one? Then they collect six or seven babies with six or seven female people, and they don't raise them. Why is Mama's little man doing that? Well, maybe because Mama didn't put enough responsibility on them. In some cases, not all. I'm not talking to all of them. I'm talking to the ones who didn't put enough responsibility on their sons. They let them sit around and do nothing and play games. They buy them everything. Every $150 pair of tennis shoes, $200 pair of tennis shoes, Mama bought it. All the baggy pants that hang off their butt with three layers of underwear and shorts on under them, Mama bought that. Big oversized jackets, the hat backward with the, not backward anymore, that's all. The hat with the label still on it, Mama bought that. Mama bought the iPhone. Mama pays for the haircuts. Mama lets son use her car. Mama never makes him really do anything. And so what is he going to do when he leaves Mama's house and meets a girl with a big booty usually? And he desires big booty. He does what he has to do. He gets big booty. He leaves a baby in big booty. So what's he going to do? Stand up and be a stellar father? If he's never had any responsibility and never seen manhood modeled? Some mothers decide that because they had a baby with one man, no man will ever be around their child for 18 years until that child is grown and out the house. How do you teach a child about a relationship when there's no man in the house and they can't see you interact with a man? How do they learn how to navigate disagreements and problems if they've never seen two people navigate disagreements and problems? Why does Mama often pick new men for her life that molest and rape her children? Mama goes out and walks around, and somewhere she meets some guy. And she invites this guy into her life and her house. Often he even lives there or comes by a lot. When Mama's not looking, this man likes to play with her children's genitals. He likes to pull their pants down and do really bad, nasty things. I know a woman who was molested for 14 years by her stepfather. The new man that Mama went and picked molested her daughter for 14 years almost daily. She got sick of the knocks on the door late at night. What I want to know is how for 14 years, Mama didn't wonder where her husband was late at night when he got out of bed every single night. I would find that a curious pattern, especially when Mama had been molested as a child herself through a lot of her childhood. Shouldn't she know the signs? The daughter ends up fighting with Mama a lot because of the brokenness of mama not protecting her. And when mama found out what was going on, mama didn't believe it. Mama told her to get out the house because she was messing with her man. The man goes and gets an apartment to put the daughter in it because she was only 14 when mama put her out the house. He went over every day after work religiously and had sex with her until she was 18. That's what mama chose to do. I know of another young lady who mama, every single man that mama ever had in her life, from the time this girl was 2 years old until she ran away from home at, I think, maybe 12 or 13, had sex with her. Every one of mama's men, including some of mama's brothers and a few other people in the neighborhood. How does mama not realize that her daughter is not just sexually active, but being sexed up by every man in her environment? How can mama not see that? Do they not talk? I mean, really? I don't know of that many men whose sons or daughters get molested. Not while daddy's around. But nearly 60% of children get molested while mama's around. It's a combination of no good, dirty men. It's a combination of mothers who aren't protecting their children and watching and learning who they're allowing around them, around their children when they're not there. Not just their daughters are being molested, but so are their sons. Yes, men like little boys' penises in a lot of cases. They like to play with them. It makes them feel powerful. I don't get it. But when I talk about molestation, I have men tell me all the time it happened to me too. It's shocking. Not only do they play with the little boys, they play with the little girls, they just feel like this woman's kids are extra sexual partners. Why do so many men molest children? Because somebody molested them. And now they're a little bit sick in the head. And they carry out the same thing that hurt them on other innocent children. Why don't mothers ask more questions? Why don't mothers be a little more curious and a little more invasive and really look deeply until they find an absolute comfort level with the new man they invited into their life? 90% of the children who are molested know the molester. And usually their mother knows them too. These aren't random people in the streets who are molesting the children. It's family members, friends, and mama's new man. And other kids who are a little bit older than them. Why is it so under-discovered by mama? Why doesn't mama talk to her children and find out what's going on in their life? Why doesn't mama look for behavior pattern changes that lets her know that they are hurting, that they are in danger, that they're in jeopardy? You can raise a child all by yourself. You don't need a man. You're everything they need. You're mama and daddy. Why aren't you protecting your children? In a two-parent home, the molestation statistics are definitely below the statistics in a single-parent home. Why does mama pick better men? Why does mama meet some guy and let him come over to her house and play PlayStation and then say, hey, I'm going to work. I'm going out with some girlfriends. I'm going to my mama's house. I'm going to the store. Here, watch my kids. I've known you for like 2 or 3 weeks. Here, watch my kids. Why does mama's new man that she met somewhere, I don't know where mama meets these guys, Look around the internet. Why does Mama's New Man beat her baby to death when she goes to the store? Did you ever bother to look and see how this man is interacting with your child? I'm not talking about all mamas. I'm talking about the ones that are allowing these horrific things to happen to their children. And we're talking about the bad stuff now. This is the severe stuff. This isn't the common stuff. We're talking about the severe stuff. Let's get a little more common. Why doesn't mama set the example of marriage for her children before parenthood? If mama has 3 or 4 babies and was never married, then why would her children feel like there's anything wrong with that? And why would they not follow the same pattern? I got here from some guy that I still don't even know his name or never seen him. Oh, I saw him twice from a distance. Mama raised me fine, so I guess I'm fine. So if I make a baby with a woman, then she can raise it like my mama raised me, and I don't have to worry about it. My mama was strong. My mama had kids with 2 or 3 different men. I've only had kids with 1 man outside of marriage, so I'm not doing too bad yet. Or if I have 3 like mama did, it's no biggie. Mama won't judge me. It's the way I got here, and my brothers and sisters. So what's the problem? How many boys have to grow up and be a man just like their mother? How many boys grow up with the female emotional print? No more about plucking their eyebrows and shaving their legs and shaving their face. They're emotional. They cry a lot as grown men, not just children. Why doesn't mom look to get some male energy in her children's lives? Work to find coaches, mentors, good men. And then when you find these good men, watch to see if they're really good men. Look for behavior pattern changes in your child's life. Talk to your children, ask them questions. Mama has some responsibility. And mama's more responsible to her pleasure, her joy of drinking and partying, her love of sex, than she is to her own children quite often. They will neglect their children for some raggedy piece of man, fight in front of him, put their babies on anybody they can just to go out and have fun, ignore their kids, spend all their time fussing and fighting and on the phone for hours and hours and hours talking about how no good this man is while their children do nothing except listen. Instead of spending time with them reading, playing, having good quality family time, all the kids hear is mama fussing about how wrong she's been treated by the no good, low down, dirty dog that she met and invited into her vagina to make the child. Or, if not that man, than the other child's father, or just some random guy she met. How much of that negativity can a child ingest and not have a very dim view of men? Whether they're male or female, not only do females often have a very dim view of men, but so do a lot of men. A lot of boys grew up eating their mother's anger, living inside her drama, until they don't respect men. They don't respect authority. They don't respect police. They don't respect teachers. They don't respect men older than them. And they don't even respect their own manhood. And quite honestly, a lot of our young men are throwing away their manhood and trying to adopt womanhood. Yes, our young men want to wear G-strings. They want to put on pumps. Some of them even want breasts. Ah, some of these young men are way more feminine than a lot of today's women. That's what mama taught them. By example. And often mom is fine with it and supports that. I love him, and if that's, I get it. You know, it's your child. Got to support your child. It's a tough box to be in. But life of a single mother. Yes, they become men, technically. After 18, being a male, having male genitalia is considered a man. Physically. There's some manhood missing psychologically and emotionally. Because mama can't teach it. Mama needs to pick a better man. Straight up. Mama has got to pick a better man. And if you don't know how to pick a man, then find a good man to tell you if he feels like the man that you're trying to make a relationship with is indeed a good man or not. Your man pickers are bad. Your mama's man picker was bad. Your grandmama's man picker was bad. You come from a whole long line of women who couldn't pick a man. Your cousins, auntie and them, your girlfriends, second, third, fourth cousins. Nobody in your family hardly knows how to pick a good man, if any at all. Women have got to realize that any man that they lay down and have sex with could potentially become their child's father. Especially when you know you don't have a condom on, when you know you're not on the pill. You know the risk. And the risk isn't just having a baby. The risk is also having AIDS and a number of other concoctions that can enter your vagina and destroy your life and even kill you. Not only are you making children with bad men, you're not even valuing your life enough to protect yourself. How much do you really know the man who you're allowing into your vagina? They can look great on the outside and still be sick on the inside. I hope you know that. What your daddy would say if you had one was slow your fast tail down. I raised you better than that. Stop being reckless. Stop hoeing around. Not in my house. How are you going to bring shame on this family? Do you know what people know about you? Do you know what they found on the internet about you? What would your daddy say? Bet your daddy would sound about like me. He may love you, but he may sound real pissed. He's probably going to hold you responsible for what you're responsible for. And if he doesn't, I don't think he's really an adequate daddy. Yes, I'm blaming everybody. I'm blaming every single body for what's wrong right now. Men, women, and adults who don't decide to be better than how they were raised to be if they weren't raised correctly. You can also fix yourself. So yes, I'm blaming mamas, daddies, and their grown-up children who still choose to act like broken children and not realize that as an adult, you can fix your own broken if you do the work. I'm going to blame the media for showing so much swill and filth, for delighting in showing shows of a black woman written by a black woman who chooses to disrupt the very president of the United States family with her shenanigans and making that the number one show that black women cheer for. I'm mad at Hollywood for making hoes housewives and making hoes desirable women. Making hoes superstars. Women who fight and call each other the B word. Oh, we love those women. Can't wait to see them come into our house and invade our spirits and our children's hearts and minds. I'm blaming Hollywood. You hear me, Hollywood? I'm blaming you. I'm blaming the music industry for making filthy music to a really good beat. until women dance to absolute pure degradation and dance as nasty as they humanly possibly can with barely enough clothes on to cover their vagina, because it seems like the thing to do, because they're hypnotized by the beat and it's telling them to be as nasty as they can be. Music industry. This contemporary garbage, this poop, I'm blaming you. I'm blaming the government. I'm blaming the government for whatever idiots thought it was a good idea to only pay child support when the father was not in the home. Mainly the black fathers. When black men couldn't get jobs and the government would knock on the door and tell the woman, if your man's not in the house, we'll give you money for 18 years. And if you ever have a man in the house, we're going to take your money. If you ever work to supplement the money we give you, we will take your money. We're going to pay you good money and give you government cheese and butter and milk and a bunch of crappy fattening food to sit at home and do nothing and teach your kids nothing. The government thought that was a good idea from the late 60s all the way through the 80s to make three generations of busted, lazy, fat butt people. Government, I'm blaming you. I'm blaming the churches. Not the good ones, just the other ones. I'm blaming the pastors and the preachers for not telling women what they need to hear. I know when I was a kid, they told women what they needed to hear. You don't tell them that now. They like having a big membership. Bunch of strong, independent, tithe-paying women who have good jobs. Some of these no-good pastors actually like the women. Churches and so-called men of God who do not do what you're supposed to do. I'm blaming you. Why is the out-of-wedlock birth rate in the church equal to the out-of-wedlock birth rate in the world? Aren't children of God? Aren't Christians? Isn't your flock that God gave you responsibility for as a pastor supposed to walk to a different rhythm and do a little bit better at least? I know they're not perfect, but can't they do even a little bit better? What are you teaching your flock? What are you doing? Are you trying to be popular? Who else can I blame? Oh, I'm gonna blame the schools. I don't get it. Why are they making co-ed bathrooms? Why are they dead set on not just teaching our kids sex education, but giving them a good dose of homosexual education? In the name of preventing bullying, somehow or another, if you accept gay people, the whole bullying problem is going to go away. Now, this isn't an anti-gay message. It's just a wake up and use your brain message. I've never heard of kids learning about homosexuality and not having a problem with Crips and Bloods beating their behind. I can't put that together. Oh, okay, I guess it helps the gay people not get bullied. But that's not the way they present it. They say it's to stop bullying just in general. I think, as a father that has kids in the system, I think that it's a ploy to change our values on a sociological level, to make the acceptance of things that were usually not as acceptable, acceptable, because it changes the dynamics of the family. What it's going to do is reduce the birth rate. Homosexuals just don't make a lot of kids. So as they tell children that anything goes, and the children believe it, and they often come from broken homes, and everybody I talk to at a middle school level and high school level says that homosexuality is just running rampant in schools, and bisexuality. They say they're bi-curious, which gives them a license to try it out for a while without committing to saying they're bisexual or gay. Just bi-curious. And they're doing it at an age where they shouldn't be having sex with anybody, let alone their own gender. It's becoming a trend and a fad, and the school system is promoting it to the point where they're saying, don't let anybody tell you there's anything wrong with it, not even your parents. So they're their schooling past the parents' moral codes? Why do they have gay clubs in middle school? They don't have heterosexual sex clubs in middle school, so why a gay club? Sounds like support to me. Sounds like a whole government-run scholastic support system. And they're giving our children a set of values that they feel are okay, irrespective of the fact that that child wouldn't exist if two usually heterosexual people come together to make the child. But now they feel they can teach whatever they want to teach. And once that child crosses the threshold at a school, between the hours of school, the state has jurisdiction over your child and not the parent. That's actually the way it is. Most people don't know that, but between the school hours, you have no say-so over what your children learn. School system, government, I'm blaming you for helping to change the values of our family. Children are curious. If you present something in front of them and tell them it's okay and it's good, they just may try it. Were they born that way or were they suggested that way? I feel a lot of today's children are suggested that way. They can't possibly have increased in being born that way, not at such a dramatic level over such a short amount of time in recent history. I also blame the food industry for feeding us that way. There is a lot of things in our food, chemical additives, and things that should not be ingested by men, that is increasing the estrogen in their body and feminizing our young men. Testosterone level in males is at an all-time critical low. Men just ain't what they used to be on a whole lot of different levels. I'm blaming the food industry. I'm blaming the pharmaceuticals. I'm blaming everybody with an agenda who wants to see broken families happen, because broken people are easier to control and you make a lot of money off of broken people. Broken people do broken people stuff, and there are ways to profit from it. Mental health profession, the legal profession, the criminal justice system, which is so, it's such a big machine. It gobbles up the disenfranchised, and it charges the citizens of the state to house them at an exorbitant amount of money, and it's private enterprise. I blame the criminal justice system. Out of everybody I blame those two people that laid down and irresponsibly made a child they weren't prepared to raise. I blame them both equally. I blame them first. But with all the love I can muster, with all that I stand for, with all my desire to see the world a better place, I'm sorry, ladies, but I do have a special blame in my heart for you. Yes. I looked right in the camera and said, I have a special blame for you, for not being chaste, for not being ladylike, for not keeping your legs closed. You sit down and close your legs, but you go home and open them wide open. You might as well sit down and open them there so everybody can see it right on the spot. Lots of people have at home. I blame you. You accept and deny applications. You decide who gets it and who doesn't. You like to brag about the moment you meet a man, you know if he's going to get it or not. And you're acting like horny, ravenous sex machines. We can't objectify women anymore because women are objectifying themselves. How can a man objectify a woman when she does a better job of it? Yes, women, I blame you. If you want to accuse me of bashing, accuse on, I can take it. I'm going to say what I feel. I'm the daddy in this joint. And I'm blaming you for a lot of your own shortcomings, your own mistakes that you made on your own free will, and how you have helped destroy your family and mess up our tomorrow. I blame you for sleeping with bad boys. I blame you for buying into the swill that you hear in today's music and acting like you're a real-life music video ho. Yes, I blame you for that. I blame you for opening your vaginal kingdom and letting somebody ransack it and happily leave their load and run on about their business. And after you made that mistake, I'm blaming you a second time for doing it again. I'm going to blame you a third time for doing it again. I'm going to blame you a fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth time for all the times you did it again. When are you going to learn? How can I not blame you? Who am I supposed to blame? Two of you had sex, and part A entered part B and left load C and made a baby. Guess what? Only one of you had to say no. You could have told him no, and guess what wouldn't have happened? Or you could have told the right guy yes, and guess who would have had a daddy? Your children. How can I not blame you? But, hey, I saved the best for last. At least I blamed everybody else first, right? Does that make it feel better? Is Tim Alexander fair today for blaming everybody? I wish we can just get the women to be more responsible with their vaginas. Vaginal responsibility. You have a vagina and you're not using it right. Keep people out of it that don't belong there. Let's start there. If a man's not qualified, he gets none. Or if you get some, I know y'all are grown folks, you're going to do what you want to do. Bag it up correctly. Double bag it by making sure that you have other precautionary measures in place. Make sure three ways to Sunday you ain't getting pregnant unless you decide to after you marry a good quality man. And have spent an adequate amount of time in this marriage until you make sure it's stable and you consciously and willfully decide to birth a child and raise it together. You ever thought about trying that? That's not what you're doing. Not most of you. A few of you are. But with 76% of the children being born out of wedlock, that is a huge amount of irresponsibility. 3/4 of the babies born are born incorrectly. Who should I blame for that? This is Tim Alexander, your radio daddy, saying, I blame you all if you're a part of this problem. Anybody that's made a mistake, you're responsible for what you did. Is it all your fault? Nope. It's also your parents' faults. I forgot to blame them. I blame your parents. Okay, we got that out the way. Fix yourself. Much love. This is your radio daddy, Tim Alexander. And since nobody called in, we had a rant show today. We had a blame everybody for everything show today. We had fire. We had fire. Goodbye. This is Tim Alexander, your radio daddy. I'm out.
leave us both apart, but words can hardly say. Only vanity will make you try to hurt me. Girl, and I love you.
Thank you for tuning in to LA Talk Live, reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. Stay tuned.